issues that I want to talk about today as we come to this passage. And they're both included in the title, but I need to kind of explain. Where are you is really a shortened question. There are two things that I want to talk about. Bad examples, we're going to look at that in the scripture. And where are you a citizen? And these two things might seem unrelated, but they, as you will see, they are related. And as I was thinking about citizenship, I thought of all the many times that I have heard stories from immigrants, people coming to this nation. And oftentimes they would come, you know, in past generations, they would come on ships and they would pass by in New York Harbor, Ellis Island, and a statue called what? The Statue of Liberty. I have never been there. I've not seen in person the Statue of Liberty, but that's a beautiful picture to me. I love the image. I love what it stands for. And as many of you know, I've got some real concerns. I was brought up as the son of a career Navy guy. I was brought up with patriotism as a great and high value. And there are many of us who are concerned because it seems like many in our country want to abandon the very principles that made us great. In recent times, we have seen situations where even though we lead the world in certain areas, because people are able to find fault in one place or another, they basically say, let's be like others and abandon the things that have made us great in the first place. And I have heard specifically immigrants say how sad they are because it seems like our nation is becoming like the nations they left to be here. And it doesn't make sense to abandon the things that gave you greatness. And the thing is, Christians are in danger of the very same thing. There are certain principles that brought us to our salvation. There are certain things that we realized about ourselves and about God, and then we stand in danger of forgetting those things and starting to live in a way as though they were not true. And so even as in America, things like liberty, personal responsibility, the rule of law, self-reliance. See, in a Christian sense, I don't want you to be self-reliant. In a political sense, I believe in self-reliance. I believe that we need to be responsible for ourselves. And yet, in a Christian sense, it gives the whole definition of self-reliance. In our very Constitution, it tells us, because we have certain things that have been given to us by God, therefore we can stand. And so being self-reliant in that way. Justice. And I'll even throw in my thoughts, small government. Things like that have made us great in a world of many nations. But as I have to remind myself periodically, even though I love this country, and I have certain desires for this country, and I have certain fears for this country, this is not my home. This is not where my ultimate citizenship is. We are aliens here. We are sojourners here. We are passing through. And as we come to this passage, there are two thoughts, as I've said. Bad examples I've drawn from the context because we've just come from talking about good examples. In fact, today we're starting, according to what I have up on the screen, at verse 18. But I want you to back up to verse 17 and remind us of what we were talking about last week. Brethren, join in following my example. Paul says, I'm living in such a way that, yes, I can say, follow my example. Our ultimate example is Christ, but Paul lived in such a way, and we should strive to live in such a way that we could say to our brothers and sisters, follow my example. And he says, Join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern you have in us. He's saying, look for good examples and follow those examples. And we talked about good examples last week. And in that context, verse 18 comes. For many walk. What is the contrast? He's contrasting to his example and others whom we can see walking according to that pattern. And now he says, for many walk, of whom I often told you, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things. For our citizenship is in heaven. Everybody say that with me. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory. Can I read that phrase again? He will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory. What an awesome thing! I can't even imagine what that's going to be. It's going to be good, I know that. By the exertion of the power that He has, even to subject all things to Himself. All things to Himself. So I want to go from really a wonderful week. I enjoyed last week. I enjoyed calling Gloria up here and surprising her and seeing Dale and Gloria renew their vows of 50 years. And I enjoyed talking about the fact that we have been blessed with many good examples that we can look to in our church. And that's a wonderful thing. Young people need old people.
Amen.
Let me just say that again. Young people need old people.
Amen.
Let me hear the young people say amen. Young people need old people.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
No. My definition of young people evidently isn't the same as some of your definitions of young people.
Vice versa.
Folks, young people need old people that are walking with Jesus, that are demonstrating what it looks like to walk with Jesus after 10 years, after 20 years, after 50 years, all of their lives. And there are times that some of us, you know, I've heard testimonies of people, and many of you can talk about testimonies where you went deep into the world and deep into sin. And I love to share my testimony about when I got saved, the Lord delivered me from stealing the other kids' toys. You know, when you get saved as a little kid and you get raised in church, you don't have the dynamic difference to point to. But you know what? Regardless of where God saved you and what He saved you from, we are all saved from sin. But the fact is, whatever your testimony, don't you ever think that it is somehow less important. I thank God for the things that He delivered me from before I ever got there.
Amen.
Thank God for the things that He will deliver your children from before they ever get there. Young people, by all means, live lives that God can deliver you from sin before you ever get there. There's a lot of stuff you don't need to experience. And God can deliver us even beforehand. But the fact is, even if some of us never experienced some of those things that others did, it may be that God has delivered us from the pride that can destroy somebody just as much by thinking that you somehow are acceptable to God apart from Christ. The fact is, we are all saved by the grace of God and through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And as we consider what it is to lead our lives, desperately, desperately, people need good examples of Christians to look at. I've shared with you over and over, I've never led somebody to Christ that did not tell me about some good example that had already had a positive influence on them. And I have never had somebody, now I'm what's the word? I can't, I don't think I'm exaggerating, but I'm saying a broad statement, I'm generalizing. But I'll be honest with you, I have had so many people, if you witness for Christ, you're going to have people reject the gospel as well as receive the gospel, right? And everybody I've ever heard receive the gospel, I think every single time they've always told me about some good Christian that has influenced them and brought them closer. And I really do believe it seems like every time anybody rejects Christ, they've got the story of some hypocrite. They've got the story of somebody that names the name of Jesus but is not walking with the Lord. Sometimes they're going to church regularly. But who they are in their daily life is not who they are at church. And that kind of thing keeps people away from Jesus. Don't be like that. Is it okay just to be that simple? Don't be like that. There are times, as a pastor, that I have been around one of my church members at some time other than Sunday. And all of a sudden, they'll do their regular routine rather than their Sunday routine. And they go. You shouldn't have to protect who you really are from your pastor. You shouldn't have to protect who you really are from your church folks. We need to be who we are. And if who we are isn't consistent with what we talk about on Sunday, we need to get on our knees before the Lord and ask God to help us to start living in such a way so that other people can look at us and realize, okay, here's some good examples. Why? Because there's plenty of bad examples. Every once in a while I hear somebody in an argument say, you know, I'm just going to play devil's advocate for a second. And I always just want to say, he's got enough advocates. Amen. We don't need anybody to play his advocate. He's got enough advocates. That's what Paul is saying here. Look at verse 18. He says, many walk. There's not a few that walk the way he's talking about. There are many who walk. He said, I've told you often. In other words, in his past experience with the Philippian church, he had told them this many times. And he says, and now I'm telling you again with weeping. This causes me to weep. And so I want you to consider the real danger, el peligro verdadero. And the real danger is because we are surrounded by enemies of the cross. Somos rodeados por enemigos, and I think this translated wrong. I'm going to say de la cruz because I think that's a wrong. No, that's right. Okay, forgive me. I'm sorry. Somos rodeados por enemigos del discursado. Now, I wanted to clarify. Well, you can't see the picture anyway. This one's kind of dark. The pictures that I've used now are just people being sworn in as citizens. Because what we're moving towards, we're starting off with bad examples and we're going to move towards what it means to be citizens of heaven. But the bad examples that it describes stands in opposition to that. He says we are surrounded by enemies of the cross. But look at the verse again. For many walk. See, it's their walk that he's talking about. And I want to suggest something to you today that maybe some of you would disagree with, but you can consider it. Because it sure sounds like he's talking about lost folks. When you use a phrase like enemies of the cross, what do you think of? Enemies of the cross, people that hate Jesus, people that hate the cross, hate the gospel. They've determined, and there are plenty of those. There are people who are writing books and starting movements and joining groups. Atheists that are putting up billboards that are ridiculing Christians. Those people, yes, they've chosen a lifestyle that they are enemies of the cross. But I want you to look at what he's talking about. I want to suggest to you that when Paul looks at lost people, he just kind of expects them to live like lost people. The thing that caused Paul to weep is when he looked at Christians that are living like lost people. And I want you to consider what he says here. He says, for many walk. They're living in such a way. It's their walk he's concerned about. Es su caminata. And the thing is, Christians can do the things he's about to talk about. And the very fact that he's talking about bad examples. Christian, don't just look at other Christians to be your example. Look at Christians who are living according to the pattern we've been given. Because, see, if what Paul is worried about is that you follow their example, then obviously he's talking about something that Christians can do. Because if he's worried that we're going to follow their example, he's worried that we're going to live a certain way that is inconsistent with what a Christian should be. And that is what I think he's talking about in the first place. But Pastor, would you call a Christian an enemy of the cross if they're living a certain way? Yes. Is it possible that we could live as enemies of the cross? Stop a second. Can you think of anything that would be more heartbreaking than that? And if that's a possibility, then we need to stop and really consider. This is something I got to look out for. I mean, Paul said, this is something that causes me to weep. There are many who walk in a certain way, and they are enemies of the cross. And it is their walk, and it is cause for weeping. It's cause for weeping, Paul says. Es causa para llorar. And I believe the danger that he's talking about is that we might follow their example. El peligro nosotros quizás sigamos su ejemplo. And if you look at the context, remember the context that we've been looking at. Paul has said, know Christ. Make it the one thing in your life and press on to do that. And follow my example, he says. And observe other good examples. And then in that flow of thought, he comes to a description of an enemy of the cross. Let's look at what description of an enemy of the cross is. La descripción de un enemigo. Verse 14, whose end is destruction. Their end is destruction. That's right out of the verse, right? So write that down. Their end is destruction. Su fin es destrucción. And so you might say, well, Pastor, right there, it's talking about lost people, right? Because it's talking about how the end of their life, they're going to go to hell rather than heaven. And by the way, yes, I believe in a literal hell. There are plenty of pastors today, plenty of churches that would say that's all analogous. No. The Bible warns there is a place of separation from God for eternity. I don't like it. Can I just share that with you? That's a part of the Bible I don't like. I don't like it that there's a hell. There is, though. Now, I wouldn't like it if those who have set their hearts against Christ and chosen to reject what Jesus did, I wouldn't like it if somehow they just got to bring those things to heaven, because then it wouldn't be heaven. Some of you have heard me say this before, but the fact is, if God didn't do something to destroy evil and sin, and he allowed it into heaven, heaven wouldn't be heaven, it would be hell. Allowing evil to continue in its way for eternity, that would not be heaven. And so God had to do something about evil, and so what you've got is a place of separation for eternity called hell. And the fact is, it sounds kind of like maybe that's what it's talking about. Their end is destruction. But also, I want you to remember that the word end can mean the result of something. The result of something. The end of something. The end of a certain behavior is the result that it produces. And what he says here is that there are certain people who walk in such a way that the result of what they're doing is destructive. Does that make sense? Their end is destruction. I don't think it's necessarily talking about their ultimate end. I think it's talking about the result of their walk. And sin, by definition, is destructive. I know I say this all the time, but I'm going to say it again. God does not just arbitrarily call something sin. God, by the way, does not choose the fun stuff in life and say that's sin and you can't do it. I know as young people, there are a lot of things you're told, don't do that. But everybody else is saying it's fun. The fact is that God has a good purpose for everything that he created. And the best way to experience the best of God's creation is to do it his way. And to violate his word is always, always destructive. Let me just say that again. Sin is always destructive. Say that with me. Sin is always destructive. And so if you ever think, which by the way, Satan will whisper in your ear, you'll get away with this. Nobody will ever know. That's never true. It's never true. The Bible says your sin will find you out. Maybe nobody will know the details of what you did, but if nothing else, they'll see it in the destructive results it has on your character. Sin always is destructive. And so as we think about this, their end is destruction. That makes perfect sense with that basic principle. Let me just put it this way. Proverbs 13:20 says, "He who walks with wise men will be wise, but the companion of fools will suffer harm." Let me just use the King James there. "But the companion of fools will be destroyed." They'll suffer destruction. They'll suffer something destructive to their lives. Doesn't that almost kind of sound like what Paul is saying? Watch out for bad examples because the result of their actions are destructive. Can I just ask you this? Who does more damage to the gospel? A pagan living a sinful life or a professing Christian living a sinful life? A pagan is just doing what comes natural. Now that's actually part of the sermon in just a second. But I want you to look at the next point. It says, verse 18, "For many walk, as of whom I often told you and now tell you with weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite. Su Dios es su apetito." Does everybody know what an appetite is? If it hasn't kicked in, it'll kick in the next 5 or 10 minutes. The last part of a sermon is always fighting against the fact that we're ready for lunch. You know, and the fact is, God made you with an appetite. An appetite in and of itself is not evil. Right? Amen? An appetite is not evil. Apetito no es malo. And the word appetite just refers to a desire, to a wanting. Wanting, by the way, is not evil. Desear no es malo. But doing what we want. Now, put these two things together. Wanting is not evil. But doing what we want can destroy us. Did everybody follow that? Wanting is not evil. But doing what we want can destroy us to one degree or another. I have seen people whose lives have been completely destroyed by doing what they wanted. And we all, I'm not going to say we all have seen people. I'm going to say we all have experienced the destruction of doing what we want at times.
That's right. Amen.
I mean, we don't have to point somewhere else. I have experienced the destruction, damage has happened in my life because I did what I wanted rather than what I ought to have done. Now, we're living in a society where the idea of ought is almost dealt with as though that was a bad thing. Sometimes you should do what you ought to do. It's a good thing to know what needs to be done and do it, even if you don't want to. But we're living in a society where it actually is deified to do what you want. Do what you want. In fact, that is some people's highest goal, to live the kind of life what they can do, where they can do whatever they want to do. I think of a sports star that wrote a book, "Bad as I Want to Be." Well, just look at that guy. And the thing is that wanting is not wrong, but letting it be your God is a terrible, foolish mistake. And that's something that Paul says here is an attribute of an enemy of the cross. Now, I'm going to just share with you, we need something outside of ourselves. We need something outside of what we want to be the guide for what is right. And I'm going to just use an example. If I ate everything that I wanted to, it would not be a very pretty picture. And speaking of not a pretty picture, that camera catches a really bad angle on me. I want to tell you, it didn't matter what my sermon was about. The first sight was, And this is the result of the fact that I chose a standard outside myself, but it was not a good standard. We replaced our scale just recently because we discovered the one we had was 20 pounds off! Did I mention 20 pounds? I mean, it's one thing to discover that I'm going along thinking I'm doing good, and I'm actually not really real accurate. I'm 3 pounds. 20 pounds! I know that I can't eat everything that I want, but I thought I was doing good. I was checking that thing on a regular basis, but it wasn't an accurate measure. I'm actually being serious here. It's exactly what Paul is saying. You need something outside yourself to check what you're doing. But you better be sure it's an accurate measure. And because of that, we need something. My uncle was a scale guy. I mean, he spent his whole life, his whole career, he was a scale guy. He went around correcting the scales in big businesses where they weigh trucks and they weigh, I mean, everybody uses scales for things. And he had to constantly go and repair those things as well as install them. My father-in-law, he served as, you know, he was a civil servant. He worked, he would go around to all the different Navy and military yards and he would calibrate their instruments because instruments get off. And so it doesn't matter if you're weighing something if it's not calibrated right. There is a standard. There are certain things. A pound is a pound. An ounce is an ounce. And if you don't measure things right, you get way off and things don't happen the way they're supposed to. Did I mention 20 pounds? And you have to know that when something is pointing a certain direction, that is accurate. And frankly, whether you're talking about Paul's life or anyone else's life, I'm just going to say to you, a marriage never makes it 50 years without constant recalibration. Am I right, Dale? There are just times that you have to come back and you say, okay, now we've not been doing this right. We need to talk about this. We need to work it out. And you need something. You need something that never changes that you can go to and know that this is always right. Because we get off base and sometimes those other folks, it's not that you just choose an example. You choose an example that is consistent with what? What is the standard that never changes that God has given us that we can always look to, that we can calibrate our own lives, that we can calibrate the lives even that we follow as examples? In fact, what Paul says, you watch for people who are living according to the pattern. God has given us a pattern. It never changes. That's why I said to you last week, I am not the authority. I need constant recalibration. And sometimes I get way off. 20 pounds. Spiritually, if you depend on your feelings, do you realize that your feelings get way more than 20 pounds out sometimes? Your feelings will not lead you the right direction. You need something that is unchanging. Can anybody tell me, with little hints that I've been giving, what that is?
The Word.
It is the Word of God. That's why it says in Psalm 119. Here, listen to me. This is something that I saw when I was a teenager. And this is something that every teenage young guy needs to read and commit to memory. Psalm 119:9. How can a young man keep his way pure? Why in the world would he ask a question like that? Because it's not easy to live in this world.
Right.
When you're a young man. I'm sorry, young girls, I'm not trying to pick on you, but the fact is, it says a young man, and I've never been a young girl, so I don't know what you face. I'm sure it's just as challenging. The principle applies to everyone, but this was something I could relate to. How can a young man keep his way pure? by keeping it according to your word. Young man, do you want to live a life that really means something? I mean, there are young men that are setting goals for themselves that are so far away from purity today. We live in a culture that glorifies people who live in such a way that it is so far out from anything that we would say is pure. How in a world like this, where you have constant feedback from a world that ridicules you if you try to maintain purity in your life? By determining, I will have one standard, and it will be God's word. It will be God's word. The scripture, this is why it says in Psalm 119:11, your word I have treasured in my heart that I might not sin against you. In Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Those are three verses that you should memorize, that you should commit to memory. Young men, commit them to memory. And I don't know about you guys, but I used to look at 58 as being so old, but I still feel inside like I'm a young man. I know, humorous, right? But the fact is, no matter what color is on top, inside, there still beats the heart of the young man, and it's still difficult to maintain a pure way, and the way to do it is still the same way, by keeping it according to God's word. See, their God is their appetite. We need to realize that God has revealed himself through his word, and so his word needs to be the standard by which we measure, and we need to be careful that the lives that we look to as examples always maintain the pattern that is given to us in his word. There are people who can be a good example now, but in a couple years they might not be. I've shared with you, the first pastor that I ever worked with had an affair and brought tremendous shame on the church. And that church spent years and years trying to recover from that. And the fact is, that guy had walked with Jesus. But he strayed. Pray for me. Pray for yourself. Pray for your brothers and sisters. There's nobody. He's always a good example. We're only a good example when we maintain the pattern given to us in his word.
That's right. Amen.
And so we need to strive to maintain a good example. And then he says they glory in their shame. Disfrutan en su vergüenza. Now, here's something that is really heartbreaking. It is heartbreaking when a Christian strays. But if that Christian repents, they can get back on track. Here's the problem, is that so many people, when they stray, they begin to justify, they begin to make excuses, and they begin to actually even glory in their shame. I'm going to warn you. I've been talking to men. I'll talk to men again for just a second. It has been troubling and embarrassing sometimes to be with Christian men and hear some of the things that we joke about or some of the stories that we tell. I have some very well-loved family members that glory in telling stories where they lost their temper with somebody and did something that was really the result of their temper. I don't know why it is. Men don't deal with emotions very well. The only emotion that we think is okay to express is anger. And even Christian men glory sometimes in how masculine they were in their anger, how they told somebody off, or how they got maybe even violent with someone. Another verse that you can memorize is one that I refer to all the time. James 1:9 and 10, I think, is be quick to hear. You remember this one? Be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. That means anything you do out of anger is wrong.
Come on.
Anything you do out of anger is wrong. And it's not a story to tell the guys and be happy about. We're to live according to the pattern that has been given to us. They glory in their shame. This is an example of the principle that I repeat to you on a regular basis. Does anybody hear it coming? Sin makes you what?
Stupid.
Sin makes you stupid. And here's the verse. I know we refer to it a lot, but it's an important verse. Romans 1:21 and 22. For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks. but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. There is a pattern here that the scripture reveals. When you sin, your understanding is darkened. Immediately. When you sin, your understanding is darkened. That's why we need to repent immediately, because if we don't, you have no idea how you can be led the wrong way, because if you sin, your understanding is darkened. We only have light in our lives as we walk in fellowship with Christ.
That's right.
When we walk in fellowship with Christ and in obedience to His Word, we see things as they really are. When we sin, our understanding is darkened, and it says here we can start to really think of ourselves as wise and still be fools. And so we need to be cautious. We need to be cautious. That's why I say, even though Satan says nobody will ever know, the very first reaction of sin in your life is to make you a little more stupid. To make you not see things as accurately as you did. And then it says, they set their minds on earthly things. Ponen su mente en cosas terrenales. Now here I just want to say what I mentioned before. Setting your mind on earthly things is just natural, right? I mean, we were born into this world, right? We live in this world. It is just absolutely natural to set our minds on earthly things. That's right. It's natural. Listen to what the Bible says. 1 Corinthians 2:14. But a natural man, natural, born that way. But a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God. For they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them because they are spiritually appraised. In our natural state, it's just absolutely natural. I mean, there's not another word for it, to set our mind on earthly things. That's why I said, a lost person. You can't expect a lost person to think like a Christian. That's why it is so wrong. So many Christians, I had a guy tell me one time that every time anybody came from his wife's church, the first thing that they wanted to talk about was the beer he was drinking. You know what? When you walk into a lost guy's house, the last thing you want to talk about is the beer he's drinking. Who cares about the beer he's drinking? If he quit drinking beer for the rest of his life, how saved would he be? It doesn't make sense for Christians to try to make unsaved people live like Christians. They need Jesus. That's the only thing they need.
Yeah.
Once they have Jesus, then they can start learning to live the right way. We don't need to criticize lost people for doing what comes what?
Natural.
They're natural people. And so they do what's natural. But for a Christian to do what's natural, that's not right.
That's right.
That's not right. We have something more now that we can set our minds on. And so what we have to do to guard against the danger, guarding against the danger, evitar el peligro. First of all, you must be born again, obviously. Debe nacer otra vez. Let me read to you these verses of Jesus. That which is born of the flesh is what?
Flesh.
Let me try that again. That which is born of the flesh is?
Flesh.
And that which is born of the Spirit is? Do not be amazed that I said to you, you must be born again. That's why a lost person doesn't need to know how this or that they're doing is wrong. The lost person needs to be born again. And anything that we do should be with the desire to help introduce them to Jesus. Everything that we should do should be to demonstrate that God has grace toward them in their sinfulness, not the judgmentalism that so many Christians have. And so when we approach someone who is a natural person, we need to realize trying to live different doesn't matter. They need to be born again. They need to be born spiritually. A life that is flesh, that is living a really moral life, is still a lost person headed for hell. But a person who is born again still needs something else in order to do what we're talking about in this passage. See, once you're born again, because you have nothing that you have known up until that time except what is natural, You must also reset your mind. Usted también debe reponer su mente. Look at what the passage says about those who are enemies of the cross. They set their minds on earthly things. That's not natural for a lost person. And the thing is, that's natural for us to drift back to unless we continue to reset our mind on spiritual things. Let me read to you Romans 12:2, another verse we always refer to. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the what?
Renewing of your mind.
Renewing of your mind. Is Paul talking to lost people or to Christians? He's talking to Christians. We have got to be transformed by the renewing of our minds so that we may prove what is the will of God, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Let me ask you a very simple question. Everybody ready? Class is in session. If you turn on a radio, what do you hear? If you turn on a radio, what do you hear?
Noise.
Think about it. It's going to play whatever it is set to. You set your radio to a certain station, and is it going to play music? Well, I don't know. What if it's a talk station? Is it going to do the news? What if it's a rock and roll station? Is it going to do rock and roll? What if it's a hip-hop station? Is it going to do hip-hop? What if it's a country station? You turn on a radio and it's going to play whatever it's set to. It all depends on what station you're set to. Have you never noticed you can learn something about a person just by turning on the radio? Oh, by the way, you can learn something about a person by looking at their Facebook page.
Come on.
You can learn something about a person by looking at their computer history. What is it set to? A radio is going to play whatever it's been set to. What happens when something goes on in your life that shakes you up? What's going to come out? Whatever you're set to. The thing is, the Bible says that we should be filled with the Spirit. If you're filled with something, when your life gets shaken up, what comes out? Whatever it's filled with. A radio plays whatever it's set to. A mind thinks according to whatever it's set to. We need to be born again, but we also need to reset our minds by continually renewing our minds by having them set according to spiritual things. Here is the thing about the homeland. Let me just read it to you. For many walk, of whom I've often told you and now tell you with weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ. Lost people? I don't think so. I think he's weeping about those who have been saved, or at least have heard the message. But I personally think he's talking about Christians that are living how? In a way that's destructive. They're living according to their appetite. That's their God. They're glorying in their shame. They're setting their mind on earthly things. Like I said, Paul would expect a natural man to set his mind on earthly things. He's talking to Christians here. For our citizenship, it sure sounds like he's talking about Christians. Our minds should not be set on earthly things. Why? Because our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory by the exertion of the power that He has even to subject all things to Himself. Here's the second point, and I'm going to rush through this. I just want you to get these truths. The true homeland, la patria verdadera, our citizenship is in heaven. Nuestra ciudadanía está en el cielo. What is our true home? Heaven. Let me read to you what it says about Abraham in Hebrews. By faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And when he went out, not knowing where he was going, by faith he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. For he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Real quick Old Testament lesson. When God called Abraham, he was living in the city of his fathers. He was living where previous generations. He was living in his natural homeland. But God said, leave there, go to a new homeland. And so he was willing to go from there. But wait, that wasn't his homeland, because even when he lived there, he lived in as an alien. He didn't fit in. He was the minority. He was surrounded by evil people. In fact, so evil that God had to rain down heaven, fire from heaven at one point to destroy a couple of cities. And the fact is, the place God had him live on this earth was not his home, but he was willing to do it because he knew he had something even better that was made by God. And living the Christian life in this world is not the bed of roses, as some guys say it is. Sometimes it's just near impossible. But the fact is, we're not citizens here.
Right.
This is not the final dwelling place that we look forward to. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly wait for what God has for us. Esperamos con ansia. We always have something better to look forward to, no matter what happens to you in this life. Listen to what Colossians says, and man, is this a whole other sermon. Therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not the things that are on earth, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Do you hear what that says? Your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Do you hear what that say? We ain't seen nothing yet. We don't even know who we are yet. It's going to be revealed to us when Christ appears, because our life is hidden with him. It says we will be transformed. Seremos transformados. This mortal will put on immortality, it says in Corinthians. And all things will be subject to him. Todas las cosas serán susceptibles a él. Why do you think that we need to be learning to live in subjection to Christ now? Because that's how we're going to spend eternity. That's what real life is. One last thing, okay? I want to wrap this up, but I just want to share a word about a man named Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Some of you know the story of his life. I've heard his name through all the years of going to seminary and so on. But he was a man who lived from 1906 to 1945. He was a theologian, a pastor, a spiritual writer, a musician, an author of fiction and poetry. But in 1933, in his homeland, his human homeland, his earthly homeland, a man named Adolf Hitler was elected Chancellor of Germany and later took control as a dictator, and he ordered the arrest and execution of several of the very people who helped put him in power. In January, that's when that happened. In April of 1933, Bonhoeffer wrote an essay because he saw the direction things were going. He wrote an essay called The Church and the Jewish Question, in which he stood against the Nazi dictatorship and he spoke in terms of protection of the Jewish people. Many Protestants of his day welcomed the rise of Nazism. A group called the Deutsche Christen, in other words, German Christians, became the voice of Nazi ideology within the evangelical church, even advocating the removal of the Old Testament from the Bible. In the fall of 1933, the Deutsche Christen gained control of many Protestant church governments throughout Germany, and their policy of excluding those with Jewish blood from the ministry was approved. In September 1933, they took control of the National Synod in Wittenberg. In September of 1941, Bonhoeffer became part of what was called the Jewish Rescue Action. In 1943, at age 37, he was arrested and taken to Tegel prison in Berlin. In February 7, 1945, he was moved to the Buchenwald concentration camp. In April of 1945, Bonhoeffer, at the age of 39, was hanged in Flossenbürg and died as a martyr. Now, many know him because of his theological writings, but he stands as a figure in history because he was able to stand against everything that was going on in his homeland. And I just began to go over some of his quotes that I had record of, thinking, I'm sure that he'll have a great quote about what it is to know that heaven is our home. And I actually didn't find one exactly like that, but here is the one that I found. This is Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Being a Christian is less about cautiously avoiding sin than about courageously and actively doing God's will. And what I thought is that, and this is Phil Inslee, not Dietrich Bonhoeffer. As I read that, I was thinking, citizenship is not so much about where we live, but about who we serve. And we need to understand, our citizenship is in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven. And one of these days, we will be transformed. And He will appear. And the life that we have in Christ will be revealed to us. And it will be greater than anything we've ever imagined. But until then, we need to live out our citizenship. And citizenship is not about where we are. It's about who we serve. I want us to end this service the way that we did a couple weeks ago. I'd like for us to just get in groups of 3 to 5 if it goes more than that. But I don't want anybody left out. I would like to ask you to pray for each other. I would like you to ask God, Lord, help us to live as citizens of heaven. Help us to set our minds on things above. Help us to be transformed so that we can demonstrate in our lives what is truly your will. Let's all stand and get in groups like that. At least one person lead in prayer. If a couple of you would like to, by all means do that. And let's spend the last moments of this service praying for one another. Don't let anybody be left out, all right?